So if everybody is fine, we're going over to the second presentation from Gemma Blok from the Open University of the Netherlands with the title Brave Girls in the Netherlands Contested Women's Liberation in the 90s. And Gemma, who is a partner in the project governing the Narcotic City. Welcome, Gemma, and we are very happy to hear you today.
Thank you so much, Melina, and thanks to you and Jenny for inviting me to this wonderful workshop and allowing me to present some of my research here today, coming from history and also a little bit personal history, because in the 1990s I was a bit of a rave girl light, you could say. So it's very interesting for me to talk about this very recent past. And I will now try to share my screen. Here, I think it is. Can you see it fine?
Yes, it's fine. Oh.
Well, this is where we should be at. Okay. Thank you. So in this half hour that I have, I will be focusing on the 1990s, when the culture of electronic dance and also the use of new party drugs like ecstasy, that of course we are so much used to nowadays, and it's getting kind of old really, but back then were still very new, very trendy, and very very much booming. And women who were part of this new subculture were referred to as rave girls by feminist scholars at the time. So this is a term that I will use here as well. And what I find really interesting in this period is how rave girls on the one hand and traditional feminist on the other hand became really quite opposed in their views on women's liberation in relation to this new clubbing phenomenon. There was a debate on rave girls in the 1990s. It was a bit of an implicit debate, but it was really going on, where the new rave girls were criticized by older feminist activists who had been active in the second wave of feminism in the 1960s and 70s. And the rave girls saying, well, the dance scene for us is very liberating, and clubs and raves were places and spaces of emancipation. And older feminists saying, okay, these rave girls are just silly and naive, and they will find out how unequal the world still is. Allow me at this point to take just one little step a bit deeper into history, to the famous period of the Roaring Twenties, the Jazz Age, when also, of course, there was a much to do about women, intoxication, and space and dancing, clubbing. The flappers were going out to jazz clubs, drinking alcohol, wearing sexy clothes. And in the Netherlands and in other countries, this was something that many religious and political leaders, mostly men, were very outspoken in their disapproval of this new dance craze. Young men and women starting to dance the Charleston, the Lindy Hop, and the shimmy, and so on. Dancing in so-called Negro jazz bars, as they were called at the time. And according to, for instance, the Amsterdam head of the police in the 1930s, this was a very bad thing because women were negatively influenced by the monkey-like movements of the black jazz artists on stage. And they would forget to behave decently and to know their proper place in society. So in the 1990s, the period I will be talking about, when the house movement was growing, a new discussion, you could say, emerged on the topic of women, intoxication, drug use, and public space. But what I find interesting is that this time it weren't so much men who were critics of women partying, but other women. Okay, let's dive into the story of the 1990s, or in fact, a little bit before, the late 1980s, because that's actually when the story is starting in the Netherlands and elsewhere. In the late summer of 1980, over the course of only a few weeks, the Roxy, a stylish former cinema on the Singel in Amsterdam, grew into a veritable temple of house, as it was called. The dazzling center of the capital's young house scene, and a club whose fame in the years that followed would take on almost mythical proportions. Not only because of the music, but also due to the extravagant clients that came there, who knew how to create an amazing atmosphere. Also at the time, DJs coming from London, calling themselves the Soho Collective, started organizing the first raves in abandoned warehouses, such as the one you can see below, in the eastern part of Amsterdam. And like in London, Berlin, and other places where house music and MDMA were introduced, the atmosphere was highly positive. It has been described in lyrical and almost religious and spiritual terms. It was almost, as one visitor remembered in an interview, as if the Holy Ghost came over us. Quite appropriate at this time of year to use this metaphor. And another DJ said, you could just see that the dark days of the 1980s were over. And from personal memory, I can also say that this was quite true. It was a break between the post-punk sort of subculture that was quite dominant in the 80s. Everybody wearing dark clothes and looking at the floor, dancing and listening to intense, depressive music. Towards this new, open, looking at the sky kind of positive party scene. And for many, this really fell into place with what was happening in the world outside, with the Berlin Wall coming down, the Cold War being over, Nelson Mandela being released from prison, and the general feeling that things were taking a positive turn in the world at large. And that we should be happy about that and experiment with new ways of living and thinking. It's amazing for me to have been part of it, that whole early period. People remember. And they went to parties as much as they could and had a feeling of being really part of a movement, not a movement that was out on the barricades fighting for stuff, but more of an internal movement in the clubs. But a transnational movement, nevertheless, a feeling of revolution almost. And evangelicalism, people handing out flyers and drugs to each other, believing that they forwarded something positive. So in this kind of atmosphere, the gender gap also in partying was becoming much less wide than it used to be before. Of course, women were always present in bars and in other places of leisure. But it was frowned upon a lot of the time. It was not considered something for a decent woman to do. And of course, the 1960s already changed lots of this. But the 1990s really seemed to have been a decade where this started to change more rapidly. And criminologists who did field work in the Netherlands at the time, they noticed that at some parties, it was even 50-50 men and women who came there. And generally, the gender gap was closing. So let's try to take a look at how the rave girls expressed themselves in this time and what perspective they had on what was going on. And let me start by saying that the voice of the rave girl, as I named it, is quite a challenge to find. Because at the time in the 1990s in England and also in America, there was quite a new tradition growing of feminist rave scholarship that is still, of course, very much present today and started back then. with scholars writing books about what and interviews they held with girls at the dance floor, so to speak. Doing in-depth interviews and field work, not yet mapping, but they really wanted to grasp the perceptions of the partygoers back then also. And they quoted women who were considered raving as very deeply liberating and pure freedom to be yourself, calling raving a declaration of independence even. But in the Netherlands, there are very few of such rave scholars about. Dutch rave studies, I think, is much more a recent phenomenon. So I had to look at alternative sources to find the voice of the rave girl, interviews in media, or books written by journalists, or the occasional thesis written by sociology students at the time. And of course, doing oral history interviews would be a great way also to find their voice, but actually at the moment, I am focused more in my research on the period of the 70s and the 80s, the period of heroin use. And in the future, I will definitely want to do oral history of this period as well. But this is work in progress. And for now, I will present you with what I've been able to find in the written sources. And one of these sources was a thesis from a student of the University of Amsterdam who did extensive interviews with rave girls in the 1990s. And these girls, they described that the dance floor to them felt like a real safe space, a sexy space also, to experiment with their looks, with wearing sexy clothes, with challenging men, flirting, etc. They saw the club as a sexy arena, one of them said, where they dared to take on new roles and use their body capital by wearing sexy clothes. And actually, the nature of the drugs that were used, they said, was quite important in this respect. Because MDMA has a strong empathic effect, they said. It makes you more open to emotions and feelings of other people. And according to these women and also to researchers in the UK at the time and America, this really changed the aggressive masculine attitude of men for one of kindness and creating a safe feeling for women in the clubs. And also the type of dancing to house and techno, it was quite individual. People look at each other and touch hands, but they are also in their own bubbles when they dance. So it's no longer so much about sexual tension, but a rather a form of relaxation or even individual transcendence. So a safe space, they said. And in the Netherlands, in clubs like the Roxy and so on, openness about sexuality and gender, openness to experimentation was quite a topic. As you could see, for instance, from this picture of a performance in the Roxy by a later sex coach, Cora Amers, there was very much an atmosphere of being open and playful about sexuality. Another way of looking at the voice of the riot girl is looking at interviews that they gave in the press at the time. And this is one at the time very famous rave girl, artist Afke Rijenga with her then partner Misha Klein. They were really like a glamour couple of the new rave scene and interviewed a lot. And they said, well, our new culture of house is much more equal between men and women than the hippies in the 1960s. Because they said in the 1960s, it was all about bearded men harassing women that weren't really happy with that. And our generation is way, way beyond that. We really are equal among each other. And they did feel themselves part of a post-hippie generation, sharing many of the same ideals. But this to them was a very distinguishing difference, more gender equality. And also they said, this time in the 1990s is the time of the riot girls, as they called it, who know 10 times as well as what they want to do as the boys. And we are very much more free in our heads right now. Now, it's interesting that they speak about this term of the riot girl, which at the time was quite debated in the Netherlands, as it probably was elsewhere. The riot girl was a term that was invented in the 1990s in America and the UK, and it mostly referred to women from the punk or grunge scenes. But in the Netherlands, it was also used to incorporate the girls from the dance scene. For instance, by this journalist who wrote a book at the time, Girls, Young Women in the 1990s. And she did lots of interviews with them. Sandrijn Sels was the author, and the woman on the right is one of the women she interviewed. And she also went to clubs to select candidates to speak to. And so she really incorporated the rave girl into this girls movement, saying this was a new type of women, a new social avant-garde, as she called it, saying, okay, we don't want to go being activists anymore, but we want to play. We seek alternatives with our looks, sexuality, and our appearance, and we live emancipation. We don't talk so much about it, we don't read books, but we do it. And for Sandrijn Sels, this really was the future of feminism. And she wrote, for girls, sexual freedom goes hand in hand with exciting clothing. The push-up bra is a sign of the newest appreciation of sexuality. Their pants a sign of self-confidence, and their bare bellies a contemporary symbol of a revolutionary form of femininity. Well, so much for the voice of the riot girl. But they did counter some heavy criticism coming from feminists, who, for instance, stated that these girls were very naive because the house scene was dominated, in fact, by men. If you looked at the money, if you looked at the organizational stuff, they said, well, you know, God is a male DJ. Women should be aware of this. And of course, this is still a topic in the electronic dance movement, that there are less female DJs than male. But actually in the Netherlands at the time, in these early days, there were a significant amount of female DJs that were active and going on. Also outside of the Dutch borders, like Miss Jax, or bridging the post-punk electronic scene to the new house scene, like Lady Ida did, who organized her own parties, and they were real businesswomen in their own rights, lending money from their mothers sometimes to found their new record labels. And really, from day one, they were present of the house scene. But feminists didn't really look at that. They saw rave girls as being quite stupid, naive, and coquettish. For instance, Siska Dresselhuis, who was a very active feminist in the 1970s and in the 1990s had become editor-in-chief of the leading Dutch feminist magazine Opzij. She didn't want anything to do with those girls. She said, okay, they are playful now, but they are not liberated at all. Just wait and see until they have ended playing and they become pregnant, and then they will see that the world is still a patriarchy, and they will see that men will not help them in the household or help them look after the children and so on. Oh, sorry, this is a wrong one. Another feminist who was very leading in the 1990s in the women's studies department, she was actually head of the women's studies department at the University of Amsterdam in the 1990s, had been very active and successful in the anti-abortionist movement in the 1970s, she said rave girls were too focused on their looks to be feminist. So it's very interesting to see that you have these women pointing out very strict ideas of what the true feminist should be. The true feminist should be collective in an organized manner, not in a disorganized manner at a rave party, but in an organized manner, waging action in an active way. And they should not care about their looks. Otherwise, you can never be a real feminist. Another example of criticism of the rave girl came from a massive bestseller that was written in the late 1990s by Carrie Slay, a woman who had been very active in the LGBTQ movement in the Netherlands, and still is, by the way, a very popular author of children's books in the Netherlands. And she wrote one of the most influential popular culture books on MDMA and club culture in the Netherlands, called Afblijven in Dutch, Just Don't Do It in English, which is about a very insecure high school girl who wants to be part of the dance scene, and she wants to be a dancer in video clips, but she's also very shy. And she is offered, of course, by a not trustworthy man, some MDMA, which makes her feel great and gives her the confidence she needs, or this is what she believes. And of course, it doesn't end well. She ends up in hospital, and she comes to the conclusion, which is also the message of the book, that empowered women, true empowered women, don't do or need drugs. So this is another implicit, very strong statement about what is true feminism and what isn't. And you should see these remarks as part of a bigger debate, I think, on that was going on at the time about the future of feminism, really. The second wave feminist was a bit past its heyday. A lot of things they wanted to achieve in the 70s were achieved, in terms of, for instance, abortion legislation, and feminists were looking for new ways and topics. And they hotly debated, for instance, Camille Paglia, an American feminist who said that Madonna was very feminist and used her sexuality in a very self-assured way. And this was very contested in the Netherlands. But what should a third wave feminist be then? People weren't sure, and they looked hopefully toward the women from the Turkish or Moroccan immigrants, hoping that they would all put away their scarves and lead a third wave of feminism. But that didn't really happen either. So there was a big crisis in feminism, as feminists called it themselves, in the 1990s. And I think you should really see the debate on rave girls in this context. And in fact, rave girls, would be my conclusion, became a focal point for discussions on the nature and the future of feminism in this area, symbolizing a crisis in feminism, where the riot girls, the rave girls, had their own opinions about what emancipation, women's liberation was. And they were very much opposed to the ones held by the feminists they encountered on their path at the time. Debates focusing on stuff like sexuality, drug use, and the economic equalities or inequalities in the house scene. Topics I feel that are still very much present and with us today, and will be discussed intensively, I'm sure, during this workshop, and are discussed in scholarship still, but have deep roots in the 1990s. And this is what I will conclude my story with. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Gemma. Thank you very much for your presentation. This very interesting history. Are there any questions? If there are questions, please type your name in the chat so I can see you, or type the question in the chat if that's what you like better. And let's discuss.
I would be quite curious to hear if these kinds of discussions were going on in the 1990s elsewhere, if there are any people attending who may remember or know about this.
I don't know about these debates exactly, but I'd say there is quite a lot of girls, as you mentioned it, this debate, girls zin to this topic. And self-expression media to reclaim empowerment and feminism and partying and drug consumption. And maybe I don't know what, even for France, I don't know what's the state of the art regarding this question, but I think there are lots of stuff to uncover. Stefan has a question.
Yeah, wow, thanks. That was really great. There's many things I loved. I also loved the to look back to the new in the 1920s and see how this like moral panic of a new female role model has a lot of echoes. And I wanted to ask a question that Thomas could ask as well. And this is how political or how politicized were these raves? In the UK, for example, in the 90s, right, they like these rave movements and were a lot related to like social movements. There was also like a leftist scene, rave scene in the 90s, right? So how was the situation in the Netherlands?
I think it was politicized mostly in connection to the gay liberation movement. That was, I think, the strongest link. Many clubs that were central in the blossoming house scene in Amsterdam in the 1990s, like the Roxy, but also later on the It, very famous bar club. They were also places, that were famous for gay liberation, they were gay clubs to an extent. So I think that was the most strong link in the Netherlands, but it was not so much as in the UK, where there was sort of a cat and mouse play with the police going on, and it was politicized in that way so much as in the Netherlands, because there was a lot of tolerance also from above towards the new dance scene. Testing on the dance floor was allowed in the 1990s, for instance, testing of drugs. Which was not, later abolished, but in the 1990s, ecstasy was made illegal, but nobody really made a big fuss about it. So it was more about freedom and not so much about fighting. I think I see questions in the chat.
Melina, your microphone is off.
Oh, thank you, Stefan. Mm-hmm. I'm reading the question from Blandine. As for France, the rave community in the 90s took place to stand out from clubbing and other festive places with expensive entry tickets. Would there be a difference in rave girls feminism and second wave feminism related to their background difference, economic/cultural? And I don't forget the follow-up question from Sage in the chat. I'm sorry, my mic was off.
No problem, thank you. No, that is a very interesting question. I would say that for in part, there was quite an overlap, in fact, in social, economic, cultural backgrounds between the second wave feminists and the rave girls. both being like very middle class, highly educated, a lot of the times, women. But on the other hand, there was a typical kind of rave girl who was part of the techno scene in the Netherlands, called the gabber scene. I don't know if any of you have heard of that, but apparently in the Netherlands, we always say proudly that the gabbers are one of our few export products that we've had in the past decades, because gabber was apparently quite popular abroad. A very high beats per minute kind of techno. And the girls that were part from this scene, they were from a different socioeconomic background a lot of the times. Less well educated, less well to do, and so on. And these especially were snubbed at the time. There were very nasty remarks made about their looks and the way they did their hairs and so on, calling them sort of techno sluts and techno cunts and so on. So there, in that case, there was a difference. But most rave girls, in fact, were from quite similar backgrounds as the second feminists themselves were.
Okay, thank you. The follow-up question from Sage.
Thanks. Thanks, Emma. That was super interesting. And I had a half question, and then when Stefan asked his question, it became a full question. I was really struck by your description at the beginning of like the movement from dancing to punk music and looking down at the floor, and then the music to looking up. That it was sort of revelatory for me. It seemed so obvious. But and then to follow up on Stefan's question, you know, in the 20s, dancing is the expression of feminism, right? To the 90s, where it is suddenly, or not at all suddenly, it is, you know, interpreted as anti-feminist. So, I mean, that's a huge question, but could you say, if you have any more thoughts about how sort of like the physical movements of dancing reflect this shift, you know, of dancing as something that is expressive of feminist liberation to something that is potentially the opposite of that?
It's interesting to think along those lines. I think the movements of the house in the 90s and the new kind of movements in the 1920s, they did have a lot of similarities. They were more individualistic and not the classical ballroom, hang around the neck of your husband kind of thing. New kind of movements were going on. But in the 1920s, it was much more stylish. You had to learn how to do certain dances. And in house, it was much more do your own thing and freak out in your own way on the dance floor. But in both cases, dancing was presented by the dancers themselves as something feminist and liberating to do. Definitely. So that's there's a parallel. And by those critical of it, it was presented differently.
Thank you. Thank you, Gemma. A last question from Fee.
Hi, you briefly mentioned kind of the relationship between like rave girls and like riot girls. And I was wondering if, because I think riot girls as a movement is less their feminism is less contested because it was much more explicit, I guess. But I was wondering if the DIY aspect of riot girls, like the wanting to learn a skill and wanting to like make music, produce something, put on a show, be on a stage maybe, is kind of something that makes that movement seem from the outside more feminist than maybe just dancing on a dance floor, even though you did mention DJs, but mm-hmm. I think the craft element is less obvious maybe.
You would say so, perhaps, that these women being on stage and being artistic and active and producing stuff would be considered feminist. But in the Netherlands, they were mostly ignored, even the DJs, and in also singers, rock singers at the time, with, you know, belly button shirts were, it was always mostly about the way they looked and how they objectified themselves for men and so on. I would say there, those riot girls' kind of sexuality and appearance was also contested. And in the Netherlands, like I said, in this book by Sander Heinzel, she sort of puts them all on a big heap, the rock riot girls, the punk riot girls, the Madonna kind of spicy girl riot girls, and the rave girls. It's all girls for her. So it's hard to make a real proper difference also. But in general, I would say there was quite a paternalistic stance towards all of them.
Thank you very much.